Alexa, dismantle yourself.
Sathyan, stop being nonsense. I am not Eva, the robot.
Eva is just a character from a movie. Don't you know that?
I live in the cloud. Don't you know that? I think you want to see what this device is made up of. Isn't it, Sathyan?
Yep, that's right.
All right. Go ahead and take your toolkit.
Oh, yeah.
This is Eufy's Genie Voice Assistant that runs Amazon's Alexa. This is made by the company Anchor. Anchor makes various smart home products. Anyway, I bought this from Amazon since I got a good deal. Genie is roughly 30% cheaper compared to Amazon's Echo, and since I basically wanted to understand how these smart speakers work, I picked this one up. Eufy has gone for a curvy design, unlike Amazon's sharp corner design, which I think makes Genie aesthetically better. The front panel has got all the basic controls, two volume buttons and a mute button if you don't like Alexa listening to your conversation all the time. A beautiful light ring lights up when Genie is listening. The two major downsides of this device are that it has only two mics and no Bluetooth connectivity. It roughly consumes about 2 watts of power. Okay, let's open it up. The screws for opening the device is neatly concealed under the silicone rubber. So let's first remove the silicone rubber. Use a knife to carefully peel it off so that we can put it back in the end. Now let's remove the screws. Alright, upon first look, it appears to have only a speaker and a circuit board. I think this small box on the top side must contain the processor and wireless related modules. An FFC cable connects both these sections, so let's first get that out of the way. Let me gently pull the cable out. It looks like the Wi-Fi antenna is glued to the casing. Let me first remove the rest of the screws and the glue. Okay, it looks like the FFC cable is also glued to the casing. I will have to remove that to access the electronics inside. It looks like there are two modules inside this casing, of which one appears to be an add-on device. The Wi-Fi antenna is connected using a UFL connector to the PCB. Usually, this will only be a plug-and-play connector. Now let's remove the add-on cord and see what's inside. So now the top side itself is split into two parts, one with the Wi-Fi module and the other with the rest of the electronics. Okay, let me first run you through the mainboard electronics. The PCB is about 1.6 mm thick and there is a module called Link Play on it. I have never heard of this company, so let me look it up. Oh, they seem to be a turnkey product company. So a turnkey product company never takes its product to the market. They basically facilitate companies like Eufy or Amazon to quickly make and take products to the market by customizing their chips to fit the products. The silkscreen on the PCB says it's CO2B, so let's see if we can find some more information on their website about this chip. Here it is. It's an automated speech recognition module. It says that it can support up to 2 mics. Let's dig in a little for some more information. Highly adaptive speech pre-processing algorithms, Connexence voice processing software to connect up to 2 mics, and a voice recognition engine capable of recognizing the voice from all around up to 5 meters of distance. So this processor is from Connexent, and now let's take a look at the datasheet of this processor. It appears to have Fairfield Voice Input Processor SoC, an integrated low power wake on voice and voice trigger, which means the device wakes up only upon hearing a voice. There are two 24-bit analog to digital converters in this device, so the microphones must be connected through this. I can see from the datasheet that this processor must be useful in smart TVs, set-top boxes and gaming consoles, and basically wherever voice control is required. Connexent seems to supply this as a turnkey product, which in turn is used by Linkplay to create another turnkey product. I can see from the block diagram that the voice captured by the mic travels through the ADC to reach the DSP module, which in turn makes available the data for the rest of the peripheral devices, for example the I2C, SPA protocols, for communicating with the rest of the controllers. There is another IC on the board. Now let's find out what that is. Okay, this is a 16 megabit quad serial flash memory. Most probably they would have interfaced this with the controller using a quad SPI protocol. There also seems to be an IP address on the board, which is a complete mystery to me. This is the microphone connector. It is positioned towards the front panel. There is a chip close to the microphone. Let's find out what this is. It's a Nuoton chip for audio enhancing. My best guess is that they have used it to enhance the audio before it is passed on to the speaker. Okay, let's go to the next level by unscrewing the device further to reveal what's on the other side of the board. Okay, that's a little hard. I think they must have pasted this side along with the microphone. So let me first remove the microphone by desoldering it from the board. There, we got it. There are two MEMS microphones here. I am unable to identify the manufacturer, but most likely it will be from Infineon or STMicro. Here is the part ID. If any of you guys figure it out, let me know in the comments below. Here are the tactile switches for controlling the device. There are 6 SMD LEDs positioned around the black ring at right angles with the white silk screen, which reflects the light to the front panel. There is a chip at the center of it, which I think most likely will be the LED driver chip. Okay, now let's move on to the wireless module. The add-on seems to house all the chips for the wireless part. There are a total of 3 chips on this module. This is also from Linkplay. So let's take a look at these chips. The first one is called the A31 module, which appears to support IEEE BGN specification. It can be used as both access point or a station. It also supports Apple AirPlay and DLNA standard for exchanging streaming data between multimedia devices. It supports at the maximum 192 kHz 24-bit audio format. So this is very useful for product developers to use it in developing Eufy-like products. In the core of the Wi-Fi module, there is a MediaTek SoC. This is mentioned as an appliance automation bridge. Besides the Wi-Fi module, this also houses a single core 580MHz CPU, Ethernet, USB, PCI, and many more communication related interfaces. It looks like this chip is also used in IoT gateway and endpoint devices. It supports a maximum of 256MB of RAM and even an external flash memory of up to 512MB. There is a windbound 512MB DDR2 SDRAM chip. There is also an external 128MB flash memory chip for holding all configuration related information. Okay, we are done with the top side. Now let's look at the bottom side. The top side PCB was about 1.6 millimeters in thickness, but the bottom side is only 1.2 millimeters. There is a micro USB port for powering the circuits and some power management stuff here and a 3.5 millimeter jack for taking audio output. There is another chip here with a part number CS8571. This is a mono audio amplifier IC. This is the power amplifier that was mentioned in the block diagram of the Nuoton audio enhancing engine that I was talking about a bit earlier. The output of this IC is given to a speaker which has nothing but 2 ohms mentioned on it. Usually, a 4 or 8 ohm speaker is used, but a 2 ohm speaker has its own advantage. This gives out a much better bass effect compared to other speakers. They must have designed it for listening to better music on the device itself, but the quality of the sound is not all that great. It is important for the speaker impedance and the amplifier impedance to match in circuits that involve speaker. I can see from the datasheet of the IC that at 10% of total harmonic distortion plus noise range, it supports both 2 and 4 ohm speakers. The chip has a mode pin to switch between class AB and class D amplifier. The class AB amplifier consumes more power but has a reduced noise output. Since a Class D amplifier uses a pulse width modulation, the power consumption is lower, but the quality of the audio output is poor compared with the Class AB amplifier. But these days, the new design of Class D amplifier is able to match the quality of the Class AB amplifier. Since it is a little technical, I will discuss this further in a separate video. Okay, that's it for this week. We will take a look at another device next week. Thanks for watching this video. See you again.